Okay, thank you very much for this kind introduction, Kyle, and also for the invitation to this symposium to present some of the activities of the URL-NRL network in the last years, also in the coming years. And I will start also first with some info on the EU legislation. Peter already kindly introduced some of these issues, so that's very nice for me. You have already the general overview, and I can go into more detail here with the EU legislation. So, first, some words about the methods of analysis. As Peter already explained, we have two regulations, separate regulations for food and for feed here. Looking at methods of sampling, methods of analysis, extraction, cleanup, GCMS measurement, or bioanalytical screening methods. So it's this 252 of 2012 for food and this 159 of 2009 for feed. If you like to find these regulations, there is a nice website of the European Union where you can find and look always for the consolidated version to find the latest version. So this is very important because there are amendments or repealings from time to time. And this is about the criteria. More details about this later on. Then second part, the legal limits. Also here, Peter gave already an introduction on this maximum level, action level, target level issue. So we have here for the maximum levels in food, this 1881 of 2006, which was amended twice. The first amendment in 2011 was due to the change from the WHO TEFs of 1998 to the TEFs of 2005. So we have a decrease of maximum and action levels in this case, but only due to the new calculations. So nothing else, it was just an adjustment for the new TEFs. This was last amended in 2013, setting new maximum levels for liver of terrestrial animals. Background here was that the high levels of dioxin and PCBs in sheep liver which were found throughout Europe here. And so these maximum levels were adjusted on a fresh weight basis now. Looking at the action level, so the idea behind the action level was already explained to have an early warning tool here for levels of dioxins and dioxin-like PCBs in food. Also here we have a new recommendation of 2013, now skipping the idea of target levels and looking to more specific matrices. So there is a recommendation to now look for free-range eggs. I think it was for this mitten crab issue. So this brown and white meat of mitten crab is an issue. Then I think it was some mineral food additives which should be monitored, and the dried herbs, which came here as an important issue because there was a lot of analysis in recent years. The same system is also established for feed. And we can see here, we have here a Commission directive from 2002, which was amended by Commission regulation also here in 2012, changing WHO TEF values from 1998 to 2005. Also here, the changes in the levels were due to changes of the TEF values, and here's some second amendment only because some values were missing, so there is nothing considerably changing there. So looking in more detail on this current EU regulations, there is the monitoring for the presence of the dioxins and PCBs may be performed with different goals. The first one is the selection of samples which are above maximum or action levels. You can do it with confirmatory methods, but you can also do it with screening methods, high cost-effective high sample throughput methods. At the moment, these are mostly the bioanalytical screening methods, KLUX methods, for example. It's important to avoid false compliance samples, of course, and a confirmation is always needed. So this can be GCMS methods, or at the moment GC low resolution, MS, GCMS, MS, and bioanalytical screening methods. In practice, this is only a bioanalytical screening method in most cases. Then the second goal is the determination of the levels of dioxins and dioxin-like PCBs in the low background range, so for time trends, for re-evaluation of maximum and action levels, for exposure assessment and so on, and of course for the confirmation of results of screening methods. And these are only the confirmatory methods for the identification, quantification of the congeners at the level of interest, for congener pattern identification and so on. And at the moment, as also Peter explained, this is only GC high resolution MS at a resolution greater of 10,000. Okay, then some look at the criteria. As you all know, or most of you know, there are criteria for these confirmatory and screening method, false compliant rate, trueness, repeatability, and so on. And to get a little more idea what these criteria mean, if you have, for example, in for confirmatory methods, a true value of 100, the trueness has to be plus minus 20% for an average value. That's very important. And the precision shall be below 15%. So you have here a standard deviation at this deviation of 20% of, again, 15%. So if you have two labs, and they can easily be in the range of 50, the one lab, and 150, the other lab, both meet the criteria, both results are okay. Just to look at results when you see them, how different they are, still acceptable according to the EU criteria. Then further idea here in this regulation is based on the TEQ, so at a sum parameter and at the congener. This makes it a little bit more complicated and complex because it refers either to the TEQ or the individual congener, looking at, for example, the validation of the method, looking at the limit of quantification for a TEQ. So this is a very interesting discussion we will have here in the future. What is an LOQ for a sum parameter consisting of individual congeners? The difference of upper and lower bound calculation. Peter already explained this issue. And then for the congeners, where should the detectable quantities be? How can an LOQ for a congener be derived? The recovery is the calibration curve, and so on. Now, looking at the amendment of this regulation, which we expect to be published in early July this year, so this will be round about the date. You're never sure, this is still in the regulatory process at the moment, going from Commission to Parliament and back, but this is the time frame at the moment. What are these the important changes in the new regulation, especially regarding confirmatory methods? First, the compliance with specification now changes from one analysis, which shall be compared with the maximum or action level to the mean of two determinations. So this changes a little bit. This changes also maybe the application of a measurement uncertainty. Then the field of application is a little bit more specified. When looking at screening methods, it mostly focuses now on a yes-no decision over a possible exceedance of maximum and action levels. And the numerically indicated value which you can obtain shall only be used as an indication for a possible confirmation with a confirmatory method. So what the method should not be used is down here, like looking in background levels, time trends, exposure assessment, and things like that. And then we have the second part. These are the confirmatory methods. And here, first time that the GC-MS-MS also as confirmatory method now comes up, but especially when checking for compliance with maximum levels. And all these, what I said before, this control of action levels, the determination of low background level is still limited to the high resolution MS. Then some further changes. What was also still unclear or is unclear in the current regulation is the definition of the level of interest. What is the level of interest which is meant here? And this is now clearly connected to the maximum level and also changed in the regulation regarding validation, regarding limit of quantification. Also, the acceptable differences between upper and lower bound were further defined, were made clearer that this refers really to maximum and action levels where this is critical, and also the calculation of the LOQ of individual congeners is a critical point, because as we have learned from MSMS, this cannot only be a signal-to-noise ratio, as you can see in some further slides. And then last, the specific criteria for high-resolution MS and MSMS. It was now added that for high-res, the resolution should be equal to or above 10,000, which was in the previous regulation not in there, just the reference to EPA 1613, 1668, for example. And then specific criteria for MSMS, where I will go into detail in the next slide. So one of these criteria refers to the ion abundance ratio. So it is said that you shall monitor at least two specific precursor ions with the corresponding transition product ions for all analytes of interest, and the maximum permitted tolerances for the relative ion intensities shall be in the range of plus minus 15%. And this can be compared with calculated or measured values of this of this ion abundance ratios. And when you look at the calculation of these ion abundance ratios, what you know from the high resolution MS, where you don't have any transition and things like that, you look only at this first part here, quan ion, target ion, relative abundance, calculated, compare it with what you measure. For MSMS, you have this additional step. For the dioxins, for example, you have a loss of COCl, and then you can get different product ions where you can calculate just how many of 30C chlorine, 35 or 37 chlorine you have, probabilities of production of these product ions. And then you can calculate an ion abundance ratio for all your relevant congeners, dioxins and PCBs. It is very important to mention that these calculated ion abundance ratios are only comparable if you use identical collision energy and collision gas pressures for each of the transition. These are, for example, these calculated values. So you can do it for the dioxins and for the PCBs. And if you compare then these calculated values with the calibration, so we did it here for the dioxins, diorto, monoorto, non-orto PCBs, you can see that the measured values are easily within the range of plus minus 15% for a calibration curve in this case. For lower values, of course, this can be difficult. And now let's take a look at this LOQ issue, which was a very important question when we looked at the MSMS results. This was widely discussed because this first approach, which is still possible, this signal-to-noise ratio of 3:1, is difficult in some cases to adjust to MSMS. We introduced the second approach of the lowest calibration point with acceptable and consistent deviation of the average relative response factor. This reads complicated. It is complicated. So it doesn't make life easier when you have to calculate like this. I can show you in the next slide. So first, looking at the signal-to-noise ratio, here we have an average chromatogram from a high-res system. You can see a noise. You can see a signal. You have a signal-to-noise ratio. This sounds realistic. This looks also quite realistic. So it is something to calculate with. And here's something from an MSMS, and you have to look here. It's a magnification by a factor of 100. We have a peak-to-peak signal noise ratio of 200:1. We divide by 20, so we are still with 3 femtogram at 10:1. I don't think that's realistic. So that's very complicated to calculate the signal-to-noise ratio here. And then what to do with these calibration runs? So we did our normal calibration. We diluted our calibration up to a factor of 1:20, so going as low as 3 femtogram, and then compared ion abundance ratios and relative response factors. And for example, here, this is for, I think, TCDF, yeah. And then looked at the ratios. And what was the range, the concentration range, when the ratios were outside the limits? So this was in the case here on the 1 to 5 dilution of the lowest calibration point. Looked also at the relative response factor. Is this acceptable? Okay, and then you can say, okay, this can be the range of my LOQ. Here, this is still acceptable. This can be measured. What you have to do then, because you don't have to do it just for one congener, but all 17 dioxins, 12 dioxin-like PCBs, and so on, you can measure your normal calibration standard. You have to add dilutions because you never know where your LOQ is. You have to measure several dilutions because this can change from day to day. The sensitivity can change from day to day. And not all the LOQs can be calculated for the same calibration standard or for the same dilution, and you have to measure it at least at the beginning and at the end. So this costs a lot of measurement time here to calculate all of these parameters, because you have to do it for every congener, for every sequence, and additionally consider recovery and sample intake. So this is a lot of calculations, and the intention is now to have a more harmonized approach also with the other EURLs in the field of contaminants, PAHs, for example, heavy metals, mycotoxin, to have a more general approach for this LOQ issue, which is more straightforward compared to this. Because what is not included here is your blank level, for example, which can influence the LOQ and so on. So this is just from the measurement system for your GC-MS system possible. So for conclusion of these developed criteria and this proposed criteria in the current amendment, also GC-MS-MS can be used as a confirmatory method. The criteria set are comparably strict to high-resolution MS to maintain a high level of the analytical quality, which we have at the moment. And what is very important, which you always have to take into account, that the extraction and cleanup process has a profound influence on the quality of your analytical results. So this point will be dropped quite often, and it's only focusing on your detection system at the end, but this can be more important than all the detection you do at the end. Because if you're doing wrong here, you can't help it with a perfect MS-MS system at the end. And then just some outlook here for the last slide. The further activities of the URL-NRL network is first looking also at the analysis of dioxins and dioxin-like PCBs in feed at levels in the range of action levels and lower with GC-MS-MS, because some labs here were running into problems reproducibility of results. Then this harmonization of the determination of the LOQ, which I already told you before, then approaches for the estimation of the measurement uncertainty, because we learned from labs that this estimation of the measurement uncertainty is complicated also for dioxin analysis, and we need an approach here. Further, the harmonization of extraction methods for food, for example, and the buildup of a congener pattern database, and then just some slides here for the harmonization of the LOQ. This is a joint program of the four EURLs looking here in this and focusing on LOQ for individual congeners first and not for all the sum parameters, which makes it more complicated then. And the next part, the measurement uncertainty, we formed a working group and intend to develop some kind of standardized approach for the dioxin and dioxin-like PCBs to provide some guidelines with practical examples for the bottom-up approach based on the GUM, for example, but also the top-down approach based on method performance criteria, like now also published in this ISO standard 11352, which is more or less the NORD test approach, which can be used if you have already a lot of data. And an important issue, which we also at our last workshop discussed, is the measurement uncertainty in comparison with the compliance assessment. What is very important for the official labs, but also for private labs doing quality control. So for the official food and feed control, this is quite clear, defined what non-compliance means and what compliance is. So it's the exceedings of the legal limit beyond reasonable doubt, taking into account the measurement uncertainty, see the value here, and including the measurement uncertainty, it's above the maximum level here. If you then look at the self-control of industry for food and feed business operators. You have the same picture here, but there is a different idea behind that, because food and feed business operators, it is said here, shall ensure that foods for feed safety, for feed satisfy the requirements of the food law. So you're more here in the green range. They have to show that their products are below the maximum level, taking into account the measurement uncertainty. Because if you're in this range and say, okay, this is compliant because it's not for sure non-compliant, you have another lab which analyzes maybe here, so in the same range, has a smaller measurement uncertainty, and suddenly the sample is non-compliant. In this case, this cannot happen. So this is just some small overview of the work of the EU NRL network, looking especially also at these quality control, quality management criteria. And with that, I want to thank all my colleagues at the lab in Freiburg, and also of the URL, NRL, OFL network, and also the European Commission, and you, of course, for your attention.